Welcome back to Real Clear Radio Hour, brought to you by the Competitive Enterprise Institute. I'm your host, Bill Frezza. For the second half of our show, we're back in the studio chatting with Lenore Scanese, who's made a new career out of her parenting practices, spawned by an episode where she let her 9-year-old find his way home alone on the New York City subway. Called the worst mother in the world by obsessive helicopter parents, I think you'll find her a breath of fresh air if fresh air is your thing. Lenore, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Bill.
So, Lenore, what is a free-range kid?
You think I would not be stumped by a question that refers to the title of my book, blog, and Twitter feed, but in fact, I am. It's not what a free-range kid is. It's the idea that free-range kids are growing up surrounded by people like me and hopefully you who don't think they're in constant danger. A free-range kid is a kid who's raised by parents and hopefully a society that doesn't see them through the lens of, oh my God, what terrible thing is going to happen to them at any given second.
So we haven't covered them in bubble wrap. We're not keeping them away from life's experiences. We're letting them be kids.
Yeah, letting them be a kid. And if you asked me this 35 years ago, I would say, look around. Everybody you're looking at, all the children, are free-range kids. Mm. They are walking to school. They're riding their bikes. They're making their own play
dates.
They don't call them play dates. But nowadays, those things are really rare. I think it's gotten to the point where I think 11% of American children now walk to school. And the reason is that, in part because schools are further away, sometimes at the edge of a new development, but a lot of it is that parents are too afraid when they're not in constant control of their kids. So a free-range kid is maybe a kid who isn't as controlled as the kid next to him.
Are we afraid because we're affluent, or are we afraid for other reasons?
Oh, we're afraid for so many reasons. That's actually what I give a whole talk on, is how do we become so afraid for our kids. And I'll just romp us through the four things that I think are making us so much more afraid than our parents were for us, when our parents would just let us go out and play or be on the front lawn and they wouldn't think that they had to stand out
there. Yeah, come home when the lights come on.
Right, exactly.
That's what I remember.
Ride your bicycle around the neighborhood. Yeah. Go knock on Betsy's door. Go out, I'm busy. But one of the reasons, of course, is that the media is just out there showing us the worst stories from around the world 24/7 in a way that it didn't oppress my mom that way. My mom couldn't have named 10 kids who have been abducted and killed, and I can, you probably can. And that's because these are the greatest stories. I hate to put it this way, but if you're a producer,
I could do one, the Lindbergh kidnapping. That was about it.
Lindbergh kidnapping. And also that was an anomaly.
Yeah.
And also the kidnappings until recently, in like recent history, when we heard about them, they had to do with usually a ransom. Mm. And it wasn't the idea of some horrible predator pulling a child off the street. But those turn out to be the best ratings getters anywhere. And so, I have one question for you. Okay, it's sort of a trick question, but have you heard the name Maddie McCann?
I haven't, but I don't watch TV.
Oh, okay, well, Maddie McCann was a girl who was like 3 or 4, and she was taken from her hotel room in Portugal. This happened, I don't know, maybe 10 years ago, maybe not even that. And it is a name that most people, those who watch TV and listen to the radio or read any of the popular newspapers, will be familiar with because it was such a huge story. The parents were doctors. They had gone out to dinner. They left their kid in the hotel room. Mm-hmm. Why would anybody do that? Everybody was coming down right and left as if this is something that any normal person should have seen coming, that your child is going to be kidnapped and never seen again in the hotel room. And so when I talk to, groups, I ask them to tell me any other story. Can you tell me any other story that has happened in Portugal in the last, I usually say 500 years? Because this is the only story that mattered from Portugal because it fits the exact template of the story that the media wants to give us, which is the idea that kids are they're always being snatched, that predators are everywhere, that the minute you take your eyes off your kid, your child is in danger. And we start internalizing that. You see that 24/7 on TV, or the rest of us do watch TV, and it starts feeling like 24/7 our kids are in danger.
Well, we're creatures of narrative, and the medicine man has a lot of power because he can weave narrative.
Narrative is the key. And also, we're creatures of the way our brains take in those narratives. Because if I ask you, is it safe for a kid to wait at a bus stop? Okay? If you ask most parents that and they're sort of Googling their brain, up comes a picture of generally of J.C. Dugard and sometimes of Eitan Pates. These are horrible stories of kids who were kidnapped at the bus stop, and one of them was kidnapped for 18 years and one of them was never seen again. The point being that your brain brings these up because they are the stories that we know. You don't know the stories of the millions and tens of millions of kids who went to the bus stop, got on the bus, forgot their homework,
it's
had a bad
news.
Day, came home, had a snack. You can't, those aren't stories.
But what are the actual crime statistics in the last 25, 30 years?
Well, the crime statistics are amazingly great, which is impossible for most people to mm-hmm. accept. And I actually think about that a lot, too. Why do we not want to think that the world is pretty good? That stumps me a lot. But in terms of actual statistics, and you don't have to believe me, you can go to your computer and look up FBI statistics for crime. Crime right now is back to the rate that it was before color television.
Mm-hmm.
It's unbelievable, but it's true. Just Google it. Google crime rate, color television. It's down there. And the murder rate, the homicide rate in America last year was at the rate it was in guess what year?
I have no idea. 63.
1906.
1906.
Okay. It's before the Wright brothers.
Okay.
So I'd say that, you know, no, nothing is perfect, and I will never say that there are no criminals and no predators and nothing bad. But if you think that your mother was not insane to let you play outside till the streetlights came on, and if you think that her grandmother, her mother, was not wrong to let her, you know, go to the corner store and buy milk when it came directly from the cow or whatever it was doing
right.
A generation or two ago, today's parents are no more crazy if they let their kids play outside or go to the corner
store.
This
has a big impact on the kid. I remember as a Boy Scout, 12 years old, being sent out mm-hmm. into the deep woods with two matches, mm-hmm. a raw egg in my sleeping bag, and being told, come back tomorrow. And
wow.
Boy, did you feel great when you came. You know, you had the skills. They taught you those skills, and
so
you felt
cool.
great that next morning. I guess if a scoutmaster did that now, he'd be arrested.
Well, I think scouting is actually one of the places you still can get a soupçon of the independence and, you know, being part of nature and sort of taking care of yourself and taking care of younger kids in today's world. I think that it is hard to find, and I totally understand what you're saying, which is that you have this feeling of confidence and competence, and everybody wants to give kids the self-esteem and the self-reliance and the self-worth, and what they forget about is those things come when you've done something. I mean, my kids are scouts too, and when they go through that cold, there's one night when they have to like go sleep out in mm-hmm. the freezing cold.
Oh, we did
cold.
Snow camping, yep.
Yeah, winter camping. I think they're allowed a sleeping bag, but I'm not even sure about that because I have nothing to do with Boy Scouts because they're boys, and off they go, which I think is just great. But in any event, coming back from that night, you feel freezing cold, and you can't feel your toes maybe, but you feel older, you feel like you've done something, you feel like you're ready to take on the world, and generally that has been the goal of childhood. You want to feel like you're growing up, and that you're becoming big, and that you're getting better at things. And like today on my blog, I had a piece about there's a new device that is for a remote control for a child's bike.
And I saw that.
And the idea is that the kid is on the bike, but the parent has the remote control, and if they think that the kid is going too fast or too far or they shouldn't, you know, whatever it is, they press the button. And so any kind of self-worth, any kind of feeling of pride, like, oh, I'm getting, you know, I'm so big, I'm a big boy on my bike, is taken away because the parent, supposedly for the child's safety, has made it all about them saving
the apron
kid.
Strings. And, yeah, it's you're tied to your mom's apron strings. I mean, that used to be an insult. Now that seems to be normal for these kids.
It's normal, and it's electronic. Sometimes the apron strings now have just become a GPS thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're either calling your mom or texting your mom, or there are all these devices now that you can use to track your child. It's just, and it starts before birth, but after birth, there's this item now called the Owlet. Have you seen the Owlet?
No.
Which sounds like it'd be a cute little owl, but it is anything but. It is this little electronic device that you strap on your infant's cute fat little foot when they're in the crib,
mm-hmm.
and it provides you an output to your iPhone that tells you the child's temperature, it tells you their heart rate, it tells you their movement, it tells you their positioning.
Plenty to obsess about.
Plenty to obsess about. Here's what else it tells you. It tells you your child's blood oxygen level, and what I love about that is that, you know, I'm middle-aged. I have no idea. I have never known my own blood. Do you know your blood oxygen level?
But doesn't every parent want to turn his baby's room into an intensive care ward?
Well, that's it. It is treating children as if they are all in the neonatal intensive care unit. And that's why I don't blame parents for freaking out or being helicopters or being extremely overprotective. I was just reading today that the company making the Owlet just reached, I think it was, I can't remember if it was 1.35 million or 1.85 million in funding, and they've already sold out their first run of the Owlet. And so if you're in a society that's telling you even your child safe at home, breathing in their crib at night, you know, sent home from the hospital, not a child in danger, is in danger, you know, that you can't possibly sleep through the night. You should be watching the output on your iPhone. Well, how can you expect to stay sane? And if you're told that if your kid walks to school, well, they're going to end up like J.C. Dugard. And then you're told if you're, there's an item that's sold online now called the toothprints, which is a little, like impression thing that you stick in your baby's mouth or your child's mouth and they bite down on it. And then you save it for when? When do you save this bite impression
for? When they're kidnapped, so you have dental records for them? You're
well,
kidding,
you know,
right?
You know, no, because if they're just kidnapped, you won't need the dental records, because I could say, if I was the kid kidnapped, my name is Billy. When do you need them?
I have no idea.
When the kid is dead and unrecognizable, burnt or decayed
stop.
I'm sorry, but that's what they're selling. And I didn't mean to get gross or anything like that, but I'm just saying, like, if you have, a country that's selling you items that tell you your child isn't safe when they're in bed, and if they walk outside, you better have their dental records, because the next time you see them, you won't be able to even recognize their skull. And if you're told that if your kid is waiting at the bus stop, they're crazy. And then there's a law now that Rhode Island is considering that won't even let a child wait at a bus stop by themselves until they are over age 12, that there has to be an adult waiting the morning to drop them off, and there must be an adult waiting at the bus stop in the afternoon when the kid comes home. Well, if you're living in that fear soup and it is swirling around you and everything is presented to you as a chance for your child to die unless you are buying or doing something or somehow regulating them or observing them either electronically or standing there at the bus stop with them, you are going to go insane, because it's a crazy society.
Let's look at this a little bit more reflectively and think about who benefits. I mean, keeping the populace in a constant state of agitation is a well-known tactic of autocrats looking to increase political power.
Mm-hmm.
How are the way we're raising our children connected to the nanny state that seems to be growing without bound?
Well, that is what has been fascinating me lately, and I'm happy that you're bringing it up, because I keep wondering, like, who does this benefit? Mm. First of all, if you're a politician and you can present anything as, quote, for the sake of the children, will no one think of the children, then anybody who says, wait a minute, that seems a little excessive, what you're suggesting, that, you know, for instance, that an adult must be at the bus stop with a child, you know, even in the suburbs, mm-hmm. and anywhere in Rhode Island. First of all, what if I have a job? What if I can't get home at 3:30 every afternoon to pick up my kid? That's too much. Well, if somebody is on the opposite political side of the person who proposed this rule, all you have to say is, like, I guess you don't care if children are kidnapped.
Right. Yeah, you're heartless. You're
right,
cruel.
You're heartless, you're cruel, you don't care. It's always you don't care. I was just reading a book that was saying this about people who are, like, free-range kids supporters. It's like, well, don't they want children to be safe? Don't they believe in helmets? Would they rather have children falling off the jungle gym onto the hard ground and cracking open their skulls? So anytime you can turn safety into this straw man that anybody who doesn't agree with you wants kids to die, you're going to win. You're going to look like you care, and the other person is this heartless Grinch.
So what happens when you wipe out self-reliance in an entire generation and they head to the voting booth?
Well, I think that if you believe that you're not safe, that is the most basic motivator, is safety. So if you don't think that you're safe or that your kids are safe, you will vote for anyone, even a tyrant, who promises to keep your children safe. And so, first of all, you sort of lose your rationality mm-hmm. when you're trying to decide what or who to vote for.
And what the real risks are.
And what the real risks are. Let's talk about risk for a second, because mm-hmm. I think that's so obviously related, which is that one of the things that started changing my own politics and view of the government is looking at the Consumer Product Safety Commission website, which I get their updates mm-hmm. every day. And I used to think, you know, how wonderful it is that somebody is looking out for consumers and keeping us safe. I do appreciate that. But if you look at the actual site, along with the things that I do want yanked mm-hmm. off the market, like, you know, exploding lawnmowers or cars that go backwards when you put them into mm-hmm. forward, there's two recent recalls that sort of sum up what I think is insane. One was a recall of these children's sandals that had a flower on them. I can't remember if the flower was like made out of metal mm-hmm. or if it was made out of fabric. But in any event, it was a decoration, and it was about the size of a real flower, like a rose. And yet they were taken off the market because sometimes this little fake flower could detach. And if so, it immediately presented what?
What are you going to do with a fake flower? Eat it?
Oh, you're going to choke on it.
No.
Come on.
Come on. On a sandal.
What are you going to do? Of course you're going to choke on it.
Yeah.
So anything that isn't the size of an elephant is a choking hazard. And then a similar recall was of a children's shoe that was, it was a gym shoe. And, you know, the little holes that a shoelace goes through?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's called a grommet. You know,
right, right.
So there was a report of one adult who had, quote, bruised or scraped his hand on a grommet on this shoe, and so immediately all the shoes, all that, like the 70,000 pairs of those shoes, were declared unsafe. Stop using them immediately, return them for a refund, you know, you're not allowed to sell them anymore because they were so dangerous. And so what fascinates me is the way we've managed to make everything seem dangerous. The word that a friend of mine coined is dangerize. We've managed to dangerize mm-hmm. walking to school because anything could happen. We've dangerized a shoe with a slightly pointy, sharp grommet because that's too dangerous to deal with. We've dangerized anything that could fall off of anything else, including this fake flower off of a sandal, because you could choke on it. And we're seeing the entire world, especially when it comes to children, through the lens of risk, which is why we keep getting rid of teeter-totters and why we get rid of merry-go-rounds and why you can't go on a field trip across the street to the park without 10,000 caveats and forms that you have to fill out, because everything is seen as what if something horrible happens?
And
at which point, the only thing safe is to, you think, is to keep your kid inside, and then we wonder, gee, why are all these kids getting fat and diabetic?
One of the things I notice, because my kids are long grown, is college kids, when they finally get free of their parents, seem to have no sense of self-protection. I'm the president of the house corporation of my MIT fraternity, so I'm local parentis for 40 college boys, and I am it's a handful. They're good kids, but I am amazed at how much little sense of self-protection the co-eds have when they drink themselves into a stupor and pass out on the floor. How does this happen? I mean, we didn't have this kind of thing when I was in school.
Ask me next year. I have a high school senior. I will find out soon enough. What I have heard, and what I hate, is the idea of us blaming parents, because like I said, I feel like the parents are in this state of fear all the time, and so they have been perhaps helicoptering more than our parents did. But what I've heard is that when kids get to college, the new term for them, not all of them, but some of them, is called teacups. Have you heard that phrase?
No.
Well, the idea of a teacup is that it's beautiful, but it's delicate. You know, it looks really good, and it costs a lot of money, and
fragile.
It's fine when it's at home behind glass and in the dining room. But if you take it out, it's more likely to break. And the statistic that I heard that went along with that that sort of disheartened me is that until, it was either 95 or 96, kids going to their college counseling, not the college counselor who tells you where to go to college, but at college, the mental health counseling, the main reason that they came there used to be because of a breakup with a boyfriend or a girlfriend. But now the main reason that kids are going in for counseling or to see somebody is anxiety. And so I feel like if we have spent their first 18 years telling them how endangered they are and how they better stay close to home and how let me be with you and how don't go there by yourself. And
then we turn them loose at college.
Yeah, it would be scary to be out on your own because you haven't had the opportunity to gradually adapt, get the street smart, get lost a few times and have to find your own way home, go to the woods with an egg and two matches. You know, if you've never done that, going off to MIT for the first time might seem more daunting than it would have been for an earlier generation.
And it's noticeable. It's noticeable in their behavior, and it's noticeable in the way college administrators have ballooned with deans and sub-deans and a compliance regime that is amazing to behold. The amount of paperwork that has to be filled out on every party, the wristbands that have to be put on everybody online.
Oh, wait, tell me about that. I don't know anything about that. What is that?
You come to fraternity party, you get ID'd, you get wristbanded. We have 5 risk managers on duty at all times, bar, backstairs, risk managers. There's a whole bunch of training that has to go on because the kids turn themselves loose. They don't seem to have a sense of self-protection and self-control, and the systems around them are supposed to protect them.
First of all, what does a risk manager do? Just like, sort of like the old-time chaperones, like, you know, keep space between you two?
No. These are also undergraduates who volunteer for risk management duty, who make sure that people aren't drinking too much, people aren't doing something dangerous, people aren't making themselves obnoxious.
Wow.
What often happens, of course, is that the girls pregame I have been by the fraternity house, happened to be in the neighborhood at midnight, and I see an 18-year-old girl who can't weigh more than 95 pounds chugging a bottle of vodka because she knows she's not going to get served when she's in the front door.
Oh, boy. It's so interesting because it's outsourcing everything. I mean, I keep thinking that we keep outsourcing childhood to adults. It's like, here, honey, let me do that for you. But it almost sounds like outsourcing partying.
We haven't prepared them.
Somebody else is going to take care of me.
Right.
It's just so strange.
We haven't prepared them for the real world. We haven't given them the street smarts because they never were out in the real world. They've been in playgroups their whole life.
And let me tell you one thing that I heard, speaking of street smarts. For my book, I interviewed the head of the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, because that is sort of the belly of the beast. They're the people who put the pictures of the children on the milk cartons and said, have you seen this child? And neglected to mention that 90-something percent of them were runaways or taken in custodial disputes. But anyways, it made it seem like every kid who was on a milk carton had met some tragic end thanks to stranger danger. But anyways, when I actually interviewed this guy, Ernie Allen, he said, A, that stranger danger was a phrase that they were fighting and trying to get out of people's minds because, you know, strangers are not mostly dangerous. And also he said that the safest kids were the ones with street smarts. And he said the way to get street smarts is you do have to spend some time out on your own, you know, not on the streets like, you know, hooking or anything like that, but, you know, walking to school or getting yourself a slice of pizza or learning how to take the train so that you're not this naive and helpless person, so that you actually have the kind of the swagger, the confidence, and the actual experience to, you know, to be able to help yourself out there in this real world and, that we talk about.
And deal with the world. Lenore, what do you make of the increased criminalizing of parents who try to give their kids a little independence?
Well, I have to say I've become the point person for that, and I find it extraordinary that there are a lot of police departments and a lot of judges out there who think that they care more about my kids than I do and more about a lot of children than their parents do. What I hear from, and I'd say a semi, like once every 2 weeks maybe, is I get a letter from some mom who starts out with her credentials, and they're always really good. I, you know, I'm a mom, I have three kids, you know, they're in the gifted and talented program.
Right, she's not a drug-addicted hooker.
Yes. A mother was at the library, and she had her child in the car, and they were about to drive off, and she realized she'd left her phone in the library. So she went back in, and she came out, and it was 3 minutes later, and it was even the police who said it was 3 minutes later, so it's not like she's trying to pretend that it was less. And she was arrested for negligence because she had allowed her child to wait in the car
for 3 minutes
in front of the library. Now, to me,
actually arrested, not just given a talking to or questioned. I mean, you could imagine questioning somebody.
No, no. This woman, JB, 28, was charged with endangering the welfare of a child, a misdemeanor, in connection with an alleged incident that occurred outside the Saratoga Springs Public Library shortly before 1:30 on Tuesday afternoon.
Wow.
So you're talking about the middle of the day. Police said the woman left her 5-month-old daughter unattended in her vehicle for approximately 3 minutes. She had entered the library to retrieve her cell phone, according to court documents. So this is not just a talking to. This is in the court already.
Mm-hmm.
The child was left unsecured in an infant carrier and was completely covered with a light blanket. I don't know if that means bad or good. Members of the Saratoga County's Child Protective Services were contacted, okay, for this horrible, egregious thing.
So now she's on the list, and she's got to report into authorities to raise her kids.
She has to report to the authorities, and the thing that has really shaken my liberal credentials to the core is that I don't want the authorities deciding that they can come in and now pass judgment on her parenting because of a single incident that I'd say any of us in America waited in the car for our parents a couple minutes at least some point in our childhood. And it's not a dangerous thing, and it's not a decision made dumbly or cravenly.
It's not 2 hours in the closed windows in a 105-degree day, you know, which is
that's
what you read about in the news when that happens. You know,
right,
once
you read
every
5 years.
In
the news, and this is sort of the other thing that really interests me, which is the idea that we can't see the difference between a tiny, minute risk and a gigantic risk. It's the same thing I was talking about earlier when I was talking about the Consumer Product Safety Commission taking off the market all the sandals that had a flower on them or all these the shoes that had the one spiky grommet that might cause a scrape. It's that somehow they are as dangerous. They're on the, you know, do not use list along with, you know, the exploding Pinto.
Mm-hmm.
And similarly, this woman, rather than dragging the kid, you know, out mm-hmm. of the car seat again and across the parking lot and into the library and up the stairs, all of which I'd say are at least as dangerous as waiting the car for 3 minutes. You know, cars could hit you.
Yep.
You could fall down the stairs. Yep. The door could slam you. There could be a robber at the library. I mean, like, anything that you can imagine bad happening to the kid in the car is at least matched by something you can imagine, if you're so inclined, happening bad at the library. But because we have been told to worry anytime a child is not literally next
in
to the mom,
mm-hmm.
with her eyes on the child, hopefully attached to the child, this becomes bad parenting. And then in come the authorities to decide upon everything else you've done in your house. And if you're like me and you have Pop-Tarts here instead of organic
mm-hmm.
O's, or if you, because you let your kid stay up late last night like I did, you know, and had a sleepy kid this morning because he wanted to watch a basketball game. I mean, these are not ideal parenting practices, but I don't think that the authorities should be telling me I should do things differently or perhaps taking my children away because they know best and I have obviously harmed my children. So once you get a third party, and it's the government with all its power,
right.
deciding that it is going to evaluate parenting and hold them to a standard that is yuppie super fantastic, then it can do anything it wants to me and my kids or you and yours.
It's the logical conclusion of starting with outlawing corporal punishment. People who spank their children, I wasn't spanked. I didn't spank my kids. Some people do. They criminalize that, and next thing you know, they're telling you what kind of Pop-Tarts to feed them.
I don't want to say that most of the people who write to me who have been called in by the authorities for letting their kids wait in the car
mm-hmm.
for a short while end up having their children taken away. Of all the people who have written to me, that only happened to one mom
mm-hmm.
that I know of. But I have heard from many, many moms, it's usually the moms, who have been visited by the authorities at their home, and their children have been interviewed. And once you're interviewing the children, it's also, did mommy or daddy ever touch you
right,
funny? I mean,
right,
it just becomes
right.
this very intrusive thing.
Yeah, away you go.
And also the moms have to then go through like re-education. Often you take a plea
mm-hmm.
bargain, I sure would, and you go to classes telling you a certain way of raising your kids. And if there's one thing I can tell you from being at the forefront of the parenting world is that there are a million ways to raise kids because there are millions and millions of children out there. And if you're not starving or beating your child, they're all going to be okay. What I'm doing is works for me, and what you're doing works for you. And if there's this one standard, and it is based on fear, and it's based on a sort of heightened idea that everything else is dangerous out there, well, then you're not going to be allowed to let your kids do anything. I heard from a dad who let his six-year-old walk to the post office, and he was arrested. And I heard from a mom who let her 7 and 11-year-old kids walk to the pizza parlor, and she was arrested. And I heard from a mom who let her kids go to the park down the street, and when she couldn't see them because it turned out they'd gone to a friend's house, she called 911, and then they came home. By the time the police were there, the kids were back home already,
mm-hmm.
and she said, oh, it was just a misunderstanding. They said, oh, no, you didn't know where your kids were.
Yeah,
this is
arrest.
Irresponsible. And she was arrested. So when the normal Sturm und Drang of a day of letting your kids go, or sometimes not knowing exactly where they are, or sometimes even losing track of them, is considered criminal, then we're all criminals. My God, the Prime Minister of Britain got in his car thinking that his wife was taking the kids home from this pub that they were at,
that.
And the wife thought he had the kid. Anyways, it turned out that one kid was left behind. Everybody has had an incident like that. It doesn't mean that the child is in grave danger, and it doesn't mean that the parent is criminal. But if you believe that any time a child is unsupervised, even for 3 minutes, they are in danger and that you have put them there, obviously that criminalizes the parent, and it allows the state to take over. And that's what has turned me into this raving, you know, whatever I am.
So, Lenore, what can parents do to get involved if they want to learn how to raise free-range kids?
Oh, thank you. They can certainly go to freerangekids.com, where I have the conversation going every day. They could read my book, which, of course, is Free Range Kids. And also what I do lately a lot of is I come and give talks. I give talks to everything from schools to colleges to corporations. And one of the messages is that, you know, what I'm advocating for is giving not only kids more freedom. When you give kids more freedom and they get all the confidence and everything that goes with it, you get more freedom. You can spend more time at your job or spend more time at your hobby.
Works both
you can
ways.
You can lean back. If you want to lean into your job, you can lean in because you don't have to lean over backwards for your kids.
Well, Lenore, keep up the good work, and thanks for being on the show.
Thank you so much, Bill. Thanks for letting me rattle on.
That wraps up our show. Thanks for joining us. You've been listening to Lenore Scanese, author of Free Range Kids, here on Real Clear Radio Hour, brought to you by the Competitive Enterprise Institute. I'm your host, Bill Frezza. Come join me this Tuesday evening, May 21st at 6 p.m. at Lear's Irish Pub on Boston Street. I'll be helping launch the Boston chapter of America's Future Foundation. See you there.